I came to Microsoft in 1991 to create Microsoft Research. My role over the years has really been to build the organization, to shape it, and to really create the kind of environment that was really conducive to doing world-class basic research.
Microsoft is a company that depends on technical innovation, and research is the core organization in Microsoft that's responsible for innovation. Innovation happens throughout the company, but it starts with ideas from research.
Microsoft Research has really grown well beyond any expectation I might have had when I started. You know, we now have more than 800 researchers. We're really one of the largest basic research organizations in the field of computer science.
Research really is about knowing that the more we try to know more, the more we know we don't know enough. So we never stop learning.
I think of research as a process of exploration in the space of ideas, really. Computer science is a very open field still. It's a very young field. What computing can do is still not fully defined or determined. It gives us a completely open field to explore what can be done.
Microsoft Research, we're working on many different areas of computer science. You know, we're doing work in operating systems, programming languages, computer architecture. But we're also working on computer vision, in speech recognition, in machine translation and natural language processing, in databases and data mining. We're working on networking technologies. We're looking at things like social computing, how to build search technologies, what's called information retrieval. We're tackling important theoretical problems in the field of computer science that sort of underpin everything.
The wonderful thing about research is that you never know where it will lead. And the amazing thing about Microsoft Research is that they support us in the journey wherever we go, following our passions and our dreams.
I am very proud of how far we have come. What we have done exceeds anyone's widest expectation. We are more committed than ever to advancing the state of the art in computer science.
The Silicon Valley Laboratory is unique. Instead of pursuing a broad spectrum of topics in computer science, we're quite focused on the area that is essentially distributed computing.
One of the exciting areas at Cambridge is our research into machine learning and perception. We're exploring new ways for people and computers to work together more intelligently and more naturally.
Microsoft invests in bringing together incredibly passionate people who have all different kinds of viewpoints. They're younger, they're older, they're men, they're women, they're from different disciplines, the social sciences, the core computer sciences. We let these people interact with each other, follow their passion, create new subjects, and in the process, they create new worlds for our customers.
The essence of research is that it's unpredictable. Some of it takes many years to come to fruition. Microsoft Research is working with the academic researchers, it's working with governments, and it's also working with industry. What we're doing is empowering scientists, empowering people with better tools and technologies around the world.
Well, there really isn't a Microsoft product that hasn't been touched in some way by the technologies that are created from Microsoft Research.
Technology transfer is incredibly important for us. We have a unique opportunity to really have an impact on Microsoft products.
And the fact that Microsoft has invested so heavily in research is an indication how the leadership realizes that Microsoft Research is that competitive edge for Microsoft.
One of the advantages Microsoft Research gives to Microsoft is it allows the company to be able to see into the future. You know, we're working on tomorrow's problems. You know, we're trying to find solutions that will allow Microsoft to do things for its customers in the future that they only dream about today.
Good morning, my name is Kevin Schofield. I'm General Manager of Microsoft Research. It's my pleasure to welcome you all here this morning. Thanks for making the trip out here. This is Microsoft Research's seventh year of doing TechFest, which is a big internal essentially trade show that we do for the rest of the company. It's going to be running tomorrow and Thursday. We bring in from all of our labs around the world about 150 different projects. We're going to have about 20 different lectures. We expect about somewhere between 6,000 and 7,000 Microsoft employees from inside the company to go through and see the great stuff that we've been working on Microsoft Research. It's a great event for us. We have a fantastic time with it every year. We build fantastic relationships with people in our product groups and our sales groups and around the company in doing this event. And last year we actually introduced something new, which was this day, which is having a public day where we take about a quarter of the projects that we're going to be showing the rest of the week and throw open the doors and invite all of you in to get a sneak peek at the kind of work that we're doing across really the breadth of computer science and more broadly in the sciences as well. We're super glad that you could be here to join us for this. We've got a fantastic day for you planned. In just a few moments, I'm going to introduce Rick Rashid, my boss, the head of Microsoft Research. Later on this morning, we're going to be joined on stage by Craig Mundy, the Chief Research and Strategy Officer from Microsoft, as well as our special guest this morning, Alan Alda. And they're going to have a bit of a fireside chat for us about computer science and technology and how that relates to society as a whole. And then immediately after that, we're going to throw open the doors to the demo room, which is right across the hall, and that will be open until about 4:30 for you to go in there and talk to researchers and see our great stuff and just take it at the pace and see the things that particularly interest you. Once again, we're super, super glad you're here and welcome. At this point, I want to introduce Rick Rashid. He's a senior vice president and the head of Microsoft Research. He's going to join us on stage and for about 45 minutes or so tell us a little bit about Microsoft Research, sort of a little bit of an overview, as well as some of the work we're doing in computer science and more broadly in the sciences. So please join me in welcoming Rick Rashid.
Thanks, Kevin. Well, it's great seeing you all here today. I must admit, this is really one of the most fun weeks for me out of the year. You know, not only is it a great opportunity for you to get a chance to see some of the great research that we do, quite honestly, it's a great opportunity for me to see some of the great research that we do. It's great getting everybody in one place. This is the only time of the year, really, that we get all of our research labs, you know, in here, you know, people showing off their work, talking with each other. It's really a great opportunity. Now, I'll have to tell you a secret. Actually, it's not a secret since I'm telling you. But I didn't ever really want to do this. In the early days of Microsoft Research, people kept saying, we really need to do some kind of a technology fair. We really need to show things off. And I kept saying, gosh, you know, that'd be such a bad idea. You know, we would be, we put a lot of work into it. You know, it would be kind of a waste of time. You know, I don't know that anybody would show up. And so I kept poo-pooing it. You know, finally I got convinced that, okay, as an experiment, we'll do it as an experiment. So we set up TechFest the first year, and I was completely blown away by what happened. You know, we had such a great response from the employees of the company. You know, they were excited. I got so many pieces of email, not just saying that they enjoyed seeing the research that we were doing, but frankly saying that this made our employees feel good about Microsoft. It made them feel proud of what we were doing and the long-term investments that we were making. You know, and then I talked with the researchers and they said, you know, we have the times of our lives. We have people that didn't even take a break to eat because they were so busy talking all the time to everybody that came by. So it was just a fabulous event. You know, and we said, okay, well, maybe we'll do it again sometime. It's needless to say, we keep doing it over and over again and we've been expanding it all along. Now, I started Microsoft Research, you know, not quite 17 years ago, 16 and a half or so years ago now. And when I started Microsoft Research, I would not have imagined that we would be where we are today. You know, we have, you know, research labs around the world. We obviously, we started here in Redmond. You know, we were here for 5 years before we expanded out. You know, but we moved on to create groups in San Francisco, Cambridge, Beijing, Silicon Valley, Bangalore, and our most recent lab that we've just announced is that we'll be opening up a new research lab in Cambridge, Massachusetts, not England. I'm trying to confuse everybody with the naming. We'll call it MSR New England, and that'll open up in July. And so we're really excited about that. We've grown from basically me to now over 800 PhD researchers around the world. And to put that in perspective, you know, the growth of Microsoft Research, it's like saying that we've created a Berkeley Computer Science Department faculty every year for 16 years. I mean, that's what we've done effectively. And really, it's been an extraordinary effort to pull all that together, and the results have been extraordinary. It actually understates the size of Microsoft Research to say we have 800 PhD researchers, because we have so many visitors, so many interns, so many postdocs that work with us as well. You know, at peak, when we have all of our interns in the summer, when we have, with our postdoc programs and so forth around the world, we actually have more than 2,000 people working in our research labs. And so that it's really a tremendous effort and a tremendous size. We've had exactly the same mission statement for the entire time we've been in business. And I always emphasize this. I know some of you probably have heard me say it before, but it's extraordinary to have one mission statement for this long, and to really have this singular vision of what we're doing. You know, we're about moving the state of the art forward in the areas that we do research. That has nothing to do specifically with Microsoft. What it has to do with is excellence in our field. It means we're out there, we measure ourselves against the work of our peers using peer review publication. We're really doing the same kinds of things that you would see being done in the very best research universities around the world. Obviously, when we have great ideas, you know, we then want to move those technologies into our products rapidly. And this TechFest event is actually one of the ways that we've developed, you know, to do technology transfer. By getting so many Microsoft employees in here, we really have used this as an opportunity to move our ideas out, to get people to think about what kinds of new technologies they can incorporate into their products. And every year, we have great leads coming out of it. In fact, when you walk around the booths, you'll see little card readers at each booth. Those card readers are there for Microsoft employees who come through that want to learn more about a project. They just swipe their card there. We maintain a database, and we'll contact people and talk with them throughout the year, trying to build relationships and really find ways of moving technologies into our products. Ultimately, we're about making sure that Microsoft and its products are really around, you know, 10 years from now. And I'll talk a bit more about that in a second. We're organized a lot like a university would be. In fact, you know, I was a professor at Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh for 12 years before coming to Microsoft. We're organized a lot like Carnegie Mellon University was organized, the computer science department, back in the mid-1980s. Because that was the model I learned, that was the model I you know, grew up with, and it's a model I feel works really well. You know, we believe in critical mass research groups. We don't believe in just having a few smart people, you know, here and there. We really believe that you need to have an organization large enough to have the kinds of interactions between researchers that really produce serendipitous results, that really make things happen that wouldn't happen unless you brought ideas from multiple areas together. We believe in working openly, and we publish our research in the literature. We're one of the top publishers of computer science research in the world. I'll make a point about that in a second. But the key thing there is that we believe that unless you subject your work to external peer review, you're not going to be able to be at the state of the art for any length of time. You know, that's not something that all other industrial research organizations believe in, but we believe in that very strongly. We work very closely with universities around the world. I'll talk more about this in a minute, so I'm not going to belabor it. But the size of our programs with universities is something that, again, doesn't really have a parallel in the industrial world. You know, we have over 1,000 PhD interns working with us each year. Just here in Redmond alone, last summer, we had 300 PhD interns. And to put that in perspective, the United States only produced 1,500 PhDs in computer science in 2006. So it gives you a sense of the size of our programs as it relates to the total pool of students that are out there. I mentioned that we measure ourselves the way a university might measure. We subject our work to peer review. You know, I can't remember any other research organization that has had the kind of success we've had at top conferences in getting our papers published. You know, it's now almost rare that a top conference in computer science doesn't have 10% of its papers for Microsoft Research. SIGGRAPH, we've published more papers at SIGGRAPH over the last 11 or 12 years than any other three organizations combined. So it's really extraordinary. There have been conferences, major international conferences, where 30% of the papers had a Microsoft author. I mean, again, that's extraordinary. That has not really happened historically. I mean, we work closely with the academic community. We're part of that community. We're involved in the committees. We're involved in the organizations. We pay our dues, you know, in working with people. We've had tremendous results in moving technologies into products. You know, if you look at Microsoft today, you know, it's so much changed because of Microsoft Research that it's really hard to say, you know, what are we doing that was caused by that versus what are we doing that isn't. If you look at, for example, all the work we do in digital media, you know, that really began with a group I started in 1992, 93, you know, looking at interactive TV and streaming data over the internet. You know, that then turned into the digital media division. That led to the creation of the Windows Media Audio and Windows Media Video, the technologies that now underlie playback on high definition DVDs. You know, it really has made a big difference, and then that, you know, has had impacts all the way through to things like our Media Center products today. Our 3D graphics technologies have led to the creation of the DirectX technologies, had a direct impact on the creation of the Xbox products, and even today, so many parts of our products, if you play Halo 3, if you use Xbox Live, if you use our matching technologies for gaming, you know, all of those things, you know, derive from work we've done in Microsoft Research, and we have great collaborative relationships. The tablet PC, you know, all of the technologies that underlie the Surface technologies, Microsoft Surface that we've announced. These are all things coming out of research, and there's so many pieces. I mean, basically, if there's a Microsoft product, there's probably something in that product that came from Microsoft Research, or the product was created with technologies that came from research. Now, a lot of people ask, why does a company like Microsoft do research? I don't know how many of you have seen. This is a slide. It's called the tire track slide. You know, it was in a report from the Computing Research Association. It tried to really capture the idea that that, you know, technology has a, you know, there's a long cycle from research, you know, academic research, industrial research, product development, you know, a long cycle to moving from an idea, you know, to billion-dollar businesses. But if you look at the investments the United States has made, you know, in computing technologies, they've had enormous impacts on our economy, enormous impacts on the country and the viability of the country in the international arena. Well, you can think about Microsoft Research in sort of a similar way. We clearly create a lot of important technologies. You know, we're a source of intellectual property. We create new technologies and new ideas that are used within the company. We create the intellectual artifacts that become products or become features of products. So that's certainly an important thing. That's a value to the company. You know, and both Bill Gates and Steve Ballmer have been quoted as saying that the sort of return on investment from Microsoft Research is the best return we get for our money, you know, compared to any other investments that we make. We're great problem-solving organizations. A lot of times people say you need research because you could have a problem and you need to have it solved and you need smart people around to do it. You know, well, we do that. You know, we love solving problems. I love solving problems. I really get, you know, that it's a thrill for me to do that. It's something I really enjoy. And obviously, you know, we're a great early warning system. You know, we'll say things like, you know, this internet search thing, you know, it could be big someday. You know, people don't always listen to us. But hey, you know, we're there to talk about it, and we get people thinking, and we lay the groundwork. You know, if you look back in some of the early days of Microsoft Research, you know, we were doing work on, you know, what eventually evolved into the smartphone and Windows Mobile, you know, going back to 1993. So we're doing things like that. But I would claim that although these are great outcomes, I mean, these are things that are important, this is not why you do research. And that tire tracks, you know, slide earlier, you know, that talks about the results of research and the impact on the economy, but that's not why you do research. I think you do research because you don't know what the future is going to hold. You don't know what's coming around the corner. You don't know who your next big competitor is, what the next big technology is, what the next problem that you're going to have to solve is going to be, right? And research creates a reservoir of technology, of ideas, of people that can be brought to bear when times are bad, when things go wrong. Research gives you an ability to survive, you know, when things change. It gives you agility. You know, and if you look back on the, you know, the writings of Vannevar Bush, who's, you know, influential in creating the National Science Foundation, he talks about this. He said, you know, we should invest in basic research, not really because it's going to have all these outcomes. We'll get these great outcomes. But really, if we have a famine, or if we have a disease, or if we have a war, we need to have this in reserve. We need to be ready. And they looked at what happened in World War II and said, you know, the fact that we had all those smart people, that helped us win the war. Right? So that's really why you do basic research. Now, I mentioned earlier that, you know, we work closely with the academic community. I mean, our belief is that it's not just important for us to do great research, but it's important for the field of computer science to be viable, for the ideas in the field of computer science to keep driving new value, because we're a company that's all about computer science. And if the field of computer science prospers, we believe Microsoft prospers as well. You know, so we work closely with the academic community. We fund students. We do internship programs. We fund faculty fellowships. We support innovative research, and that's critical to us. If you look at our footprint around the world, we have our research labs. You know, I mentioned those earlier. But we also have extensive research collaborations with universities all around the world. And this, you know, the little yellow dots there, those represent joint research labs, research collaborations, joint centers that we've created with other organizations. I'll give you a specific example. I'll pick one part of the world, which is Europe, and give you a very specific example of the depth of our interactions there. We created a few years ago something we called the European Science Initiative. You know, today we're engaged with more than 100 universities in the EU. You know, we've got fellowship programs, early career programs for faculty, over 100 PhD scholarships. We've worked and reached out to the scientific community to help set an agenda for science in Europe. With this 2020 science report, some of you may have seen in Nature, you know, came out of a conference we put together of top scientists throughout Europe. And we've created, you know, awards and programs to help drive things. Over the last 18 months or so, we've announced 3 joint research centers in Europe where our researchers are working with researchers, you know, in Italy, in areas of computational and systems biology, in France with INRIA, where, you know, Microsoft Research and INRIA are jointly tackling a large set of issues. And the most recent announcement was the new joint research center with a supercomputer center in Barcelona. So we're expanding those kinds of relationships. This video, we'll kind of expand on it. Stephen Emmett and will be talking about the sort of breadth of things we're doing with this European Science Initiative. Please roll the video. I was told.
A potentially profoundly important development is just getting underway, with equally profound technological, economic, and social implications. And it's happening at the intersection of computing and science.
We're building new software tools based upon computer science concepts, a task set to become central to developing a predictive science of complex natural systems, which is urgently needed to address some of the greatest challenges this century, from understanding biology to systems level, which would revolutionize how we treat disease, to understanding the rapid changes occurring to the life support system we depend upon for survival, our biosphere. Doing science promises not only to accelerate breakthroughs in systems biology, but also in systems engineering of tomorrow's complex computer systems. We're leading over 20 projects in areas from biochemistry to climate modeling. Here's a little glimpse of four of them. We're contributing to a radical rethinking of biology by building new programming languages to model complex dynamic processes in biology. This language, SPIM, based upon the stochastic pi calculus, has been developed by Andrew Phillips and supports visual editing, automatic graph layout, modular scalable models and probabilistic simulation, and is now being used to model and understand the immune system. Large-scale epidemic simulations are vital to understanding their potential impact worldwide and to evaluate scenarios for containment and emergency response. But existing epidemic models are limited to less than 300 million people. In collaboration with Neil Ferguson of Imperial College and the Medical Research Council, we're developing the world's first agent-based global epidemic modelling system, which could revolutionise our ability to understand, predict and contain epidemics. Plant communities are vital to climate system regulation, but surprisingly these communities, especially the world's forests, are the single largest source of uncertainty in climate models because so little is known about their biological processes across individual to global scales. Drew Purvis of our Computational Ecology Group is developing the novel process-based models, parameter estimation schemes, visualization and data collection technologies needed to make accurate predictions of global forest dynamics. Understanding structure and dynamics of complex networks is a central problem in ecology and in fields as diverse as molecular biology, economics and software engineering. We're developing models for studying system-wide effects of species extinctions and ecosystem function. Network 3D is a tool we've developed for the analysis and visualization of these models, which generates appropriate user interface elements dynamically, permitting rapid incorporation of new techniques.
Hopefully gives you a little taste, you know, of the breadth of activities we have going on in Europe. One thing that always, frankly, surprises me when I walk around TechFest is the breadth of things that we do. I mean, I think it's the one, you know, single fact that I always carry away from this week is wow, we're working in so many different areas. Whether, you know, on the one hand, you know, we're doing things that sort of feel to me like, you know, traditional, you know, sort of plumbing level computer science, programming languages, operating systems, hardware architectures, things of that sort. But we're also, you know, stretching out to areas that you might not expect. I mean, we're working in things like vaccine design, it's computational biology, quantum computing. Sometimes you just wonder, like, well, what does that quite have to do with Microsoft? Well, the answer is it doesn't necessarily have to. Although, historically, we found that when our researchers do great research, there's almost always a positive impact on the things that we do in the company. You know, so it's been good for us to be able to take this approach. Let me just give you some examples. Some of these are things that you'll see out on the floor as you walk around. You know, over the last decade, Microsoft Research has really been pioneering tools to be able to prove properties of programs of hundreds of thousands or millions of lines. We've really taken an initiative in this area, really pushing the state of the art in a significant way. These tools have both yielded great things for us internally. It lets us develop much larger systems than we might be able to. But we've also begun to distribute some of these tools and make them available. Windows Vista, for example, as part of its device developer kit, has a proof tool, a software proof tool, that is used by our device driver partners. So the people, the hardware vendors that are producing new devices, you know, they can now use this tool to prove something like 38 different properties of their programs, so that their device drivers can be more reliable than before. And this really gives them a tool, puts a tool in their hands that allows them to do better for their customers. We've pioneered not just, you know, the SLAM tool is an example of what's called a safety tool, meaning it's able to prove safety properties of programs. We've also been able to make a breakthrough just in the last 18 months or so in what's called termination properties or liveness properties of programs. So for the first time, on a large scale, we can actually prove whether a program can terminate. We can actually demonstrate a set of liveness properties to complement the safety properties we've proven before. These new tools that really let us analyze software at a large scale in ways we were never able to do before have led us to look at new ways of thinking about developing software too. And that has led to the creation of something called Singularity. Singularity is sort of a concept car operating system. It's a new system that's been built from the ground up with a specific goal of being more reliable, taking advantage of proof technologies, of specification technologies, of new kinds of system architectures that allow us to compose approved programs or approved components. Singularity really is a new way of thinking about building systems. And although you're not actually going to see Singularity, there's no booth for it. I'm not sure how you would talk about it in a booth because it's an operating system. As of, I think, 11 o'clock this morning, we're making Singularity available to the academic community and the research community for free. It'll be on Microsoft CodePlex. And so this is really, going to be an exciting thing that we're doing for the broad community by making available this kind of unique new kind of operating system. You know, we're also working with the community to think about ways of doing new kinds of computer architectures. I mean, one of the problems, you know, as it's become more and more difficult, more and more complex to build chips, is that within the academic community, it's much harder today to experiment with computer architectures. You know, and that affects us, because we like to do such experimentation, but it affects our academic colleagues as well. Well, Chuck Thacker, who's really the brains behind the original Xerox Alto design, sort of one of the fathers of the personal computer, and John Davis, one of our researchers in our Silicon Valley Research Lab, have been working with the University of California, Berkeley, on a new emulation engine. It's called B3. That's Berkeley Emulation Engine 3. And it really, the idea behind it is to build a computer system that is configurable. Basically, this is a system that they've designed that has four large FPGAs, you know, commercial FPGAs, 64 gigabytes of fast memory per node, many kinds of high-speed input and output ports. And it really will give people in the research community an opportunity to now experiment with the creation of new computer architectures in ways they would not have been able to do before. Effectively, what they can do is program this computer to be another computer or to do another kind of architecture and to experiment with new kinds of algorithms. You will see this. There's a great demonstration of this that's in the TechFest area. Now, we're not just working on the sort of core computer science areas. We're also looking at the ways human beings interact with computers. And I'd like to bring Mary Morris on stage now to talk about some work we're doing in collaboration, real-time collaboration with people using the internet. Mary?
Thanks. Good morning. I'm excited to have this chance to talk with you about my research on supporting collaborative web search. So currently, the tools that people use for searching for information online are primarily web browsers and the websites for search engine companies. But these tools are designed for a single person working alone by him or herself. But that's not always the way that we work. For example, business colleagues need to work together to jointly research projects that they're doing. Students in school need to work together, again, on group reports and homework assignments. Friends look online together to find joint entertainment opportunities. And family members often need to search the web in order to do activities like jointly planning vacation travel or searching for medical information for a loved one. So in my research, I'm interested in designing tools to make these sorts of collaborative search experiences possible and pleasurable. We began this research by doing a survey of about 200 people to learn more about the ways that people currently are trying to collaborate when they search online. And this research helped us uncover some of the obstacles to collaborating with current tools. For example, there can be a lot of unnecessary redundant effort when people try to collaborate today. One of our survey respondents articulated this well, talking about a search he tried to do with a business colleague. He said, "It was difficult for us to do our search together because we each wanted to follow different paths through the information. So doing it together was less productive. But when we did it separately, we weren't sure how much redundant information we were gathering." That might sound familiar to you. Another problem is the lack of shared context for collaborators. Another survey respondent described a time when he and a friend were trying to plan a vacation. They were in separate houses, and they were each viewing a web browser and talking to each other on the phone at the same time. So he said, "We were both searching for hotels online. The difficulty we had was in comparing the hotels. So I would say things into the phone like, type X, click the third result. See the link on the left that says more? Click that one. Now look at the second hotel." And that was very inefficient. So we're interested in designing tools to help make these types of collaborative experiences more effective. The first tool I'm going to show you today is called Search Together. And Search Together is designed for scenarios where each collaborator has his or her own computer. So I'll show you a demo right now, actually. I'm going to open up Internet Explorer. So you can see this is my computer closest to me. The other screen is showing my friend Matt's computer. So Search Together is a sidebar that runs as a plugin to Internet Explorer. I'm already logged in using my Windows Live ID, which means that I can invite any of my IM chat buddies to join in a collaborative search with me. This list here shows all of the different search sessions that I'm a member of, so I can collaborate with a different set of people on different topics. For example, my husband and I have a session about which hybrid car we should buy. My mother and I have a search session where we're searching for diabetes-friendly recipes that she can prepare. Right now, I'm logged into a session with my friend Matt where we're planning a ski trip we're going to take to celebrate our successful TechFest demonstration. So the first thing you might notice, Matt and I are both logged in, and on my computer, you can see the group query history. So here you can see a list of all the search keywords that either Matt or I has entered on this topic. And this is meant to address the issue of wasted redundant effort that appeared as a problem during our survey. Because now I can see what keywords Matt has already searched for. He's searched for Whistler discount lift tickets. I know that I don't need to do that search myself. If I want to see what Matt's done, I can click on any item from his history in order to see the search results that he saw. Another way that we can collaborate and, again, be more efficient and avoid redundancy is through a special search technique that we call split searching. So let's say I want to search for restaurants near Whistler. When I do a split search, half of the top 50 search results for this topic are going to show up in my browser. And the other half are going to show up in Matt's browser. So this is a way that each of us can look at a non-overlapping portion of results for the same query so that we can explore this issue in depth in parallel. This can also be a really interesting way for novices and experts to collaborate on a single search. For example, novices often have difficulty forming good queries or using advanced query syntax. So the more experienced searcher could type the query, but then the novice could still participate in the activity by helping look through and evaluate the search results. Right now, I'm going to look at a particular search result. This isn't a particularly exciting restaurant, but pretend that it were, and I might type in, "Let's go eat here," and even give it a good rating, like a thumbs up. And so this comment that I wrote actually appears in a special summary that Matt's going to view on his computer right now. So this summary, in essence, represents the product of our collaboration. It shows a list of all of the websites that either Matt or I has found on this topic and commented on or given good ratings to. And the summary itself is interactive. If Matt clicks on one of the items, he can easily get back to that web page. He can also easily email this summary to anyone else as a way to further extend the collaboration outside of our little group. One of the other difficulties that our survey respondents mentioned was trouble maintaining awareness of the context of their collaborators. So we've added special features that we call peek and follow that enable additional awareness of what your collaborators are doing. So for example, if you take a look at my computer, I'm going to click this special peek icon next to Matt's picture. And that lets me see whatever page he was currently viewing in his browser so that I can tell what he's working on right now. And I'm able to do this because Matt has granted me special privacy permissions because I'm a very trusted buddy of his and we're involved in this very close collaboration right now. So I'm going to move on so that I can talk about a different prototype, but I hope you stop by our booth later and I can show you more of the features of Search Together. So if we go back to the slides, Search Together was designed for a situation where all of the collaborators had their own computer, but this isn't always the case. It's very common, especially in settings like schools or even in the developing world, where computing resources are scarce, for groups of people to gather around a single computer. This is especially common in schools where groups of students will work together to research a topic for a report that they're working on together. As many of you might know, sharing a computer with others can be frustrating. Only one person is controlling the keyboard and the mouse, and it's very difficult for the other group members to contribute. So in response to that, we've developed CoSearch, which is a special system that is meant to enrich collaborative web search around a single shared computer. So CoSearch consists of a special web browser that runs on the shared computer, and that can be connected to by either multiple mice or by students' cell phones, can connect to the computer over Bluetooth, so that even the students who don't have access to the mouse and keyboard can interact with the shared browser through their phones. And I'll show you here a couple examples of the type of functionality CoSearch enables. So here, this student is using the joystick on his phone to operate a cursor in the shared browser. When he clicks on a browser tab, that page is loaded into his phone so that he can scroll through and read at his own pace because the student controlling the main display was scrolling too quickly for him. In another example, the student is typing a query keyword into his phone the same way that he would type a text message, and now he's sending that to the shared browser, where it's going to appear in a space that we call the query queue. So this is a place where members of the group can all send their queries, and they queue up in a list, and then they can pick which query they're currently going to explore on the shared screen. So again, this is a way for the students who aren't in control of the mouse and keyboard to still have a voice and participate in the search activity. So in summary, I got to give you a brief introduction to our research on supporting collaborative web search, Search Together for when everyone has their own computer, and CoSearch for when people must share. And I hope that you can stop by our booth to get more in-depth demos of both of these applications. Thank you.
Thanks, Mary. Now, another theme you may see, it's time for something to happen. I forgot to say, silence your cell phones. Another theme I think that you'll see emerging from a number of the exhibits is this notion of wireless sensing. You know, really being able to, we're now in a fundamental way able to think about collecting large amounts of information from our environment, be able to process that information and use it in really exciting ways. One of the devices you're actually going to see if you walk around is this one right here. In fact, I've been told I'm going to be in real trouble if I lose it, because it's one of the prototypes. This is a Microsoft research-designed wireless sensor. It's being developed by Feng Zhao and his research team here in Microsoft Research in Redmond. And really, this is a device that can collect a lot of information about the environment, whether it's it can get information on temperature, motion sensing, a variety of different things, plus it has the ability to have other sensors plugged into it. This is a wireless device. You can spread these out into an environment. They can communicate together, and they can communicate with ordinary PCs using standard web server, web browser kinds of technologies. The key thing here is this notion that you can use devices like this to collect data, for example, in your home, if you want to be able to use energy more efficiently. We're We've been using technology like this to collect data and understand what happens in our very large data centers, which can save us an enormous amount of money and reduce our power footprint and make our data centers more green. So technologies like this are very exciting, and you're seeing more and more of it happening. Now, you can imagine distributing sensors like this into an environment as well, and we're working with a number of groups and a number of scientists to do just that. I mean, this is an example of us where we're working. This is Catherine Van Ingen in our research lab in the Bay Area. You know, she's been working with the University of California, Berkeley, and a number of other groups to help build out what's called the Berkeley Water Center. And the idea is to be able to collect huge amounts of hydrology information in Northern California, be able to understand what's really happening in that ecosystem, and be able to do modeling that can begin to predict, you know, how water resources change, what's happening to water, what's happening to water quality. So this is exciting work. They've built a collaboration SharePoint server that currently is serving over 900 site years of carbon climate data. And this is really helping environmental scientists understand more about the world around them. Another example is some work you also see here at TechFest, which is we're working with Project Neptune at the University of Washington and a number of oceanography groups around the country to help build a platform for being able to process scientific workflows. In particular, these are oceanographic workflows. They're in the process of distributing thousands of kilometers of sensors on the floor of the ocean off the Strait of Juan de Fuca to really be able to measure what's happening in the deep ocean at a level of granularity that no one could ever really do before. And we need the tools to be able to do that, to be able to process the information. And you'll have a chance to see that at TechFest. Now, the last thing I'm going to talk about is something I think is really exciting. I know some of you, some of the reporters who were at the reception last night had a chance to see this. This is very exciting work that is really a follow-on, so historically, to the work of Jim Gray in the Terra server and the Sky server. This is work by Curtis Wong and Jonathan Fay, where they've really been able to build something called the Worldwide Telescope. It's a new way of thinking about looking at the sky, being able to collect all the great data from the great telescopes around the world, be able to pull that into a single view that looks like the sky, that gives you a sense of being able to look out to the sky. So you're not confined to just using telescopes. You're not confined to data from only one data source. What Curtis and Jonathan have done is really pull all these things together, working with top astronomers and top astronomy laboratories around the world. So with that, I'm going to let them run this demo. This, by the way, this demo was actually recorded. It's running within the application itself. It was because the application supports the notion of tours. It was recorded at TED just a week or so ago. And the voice you'll be hearing is Roy Gould, one of the top astrophysicists in the world at Harvard. Go ahead and roll it, or play it, run it.
Less than a year from now, the world is going to celebrate the International Year of Astronomy, which marks the 400th anniversary of Galileo's first glimpse of the night sky through a telescope. In a few months, the world is also going to celebrate the launch of a new invention from Microsoft Research, which I think is going to have as profound an impact on the way we view the universe as Galileo did four centuries ago. It's called the Worldwide Telescope, and I want to thank TED and Microsoft for allowing me to bring it to your attention. And I want to urge you, when you get a chance, to give it a closer look at the TED lab downstairs. The Worldwide Telescope takes the best images from the world's greatest telescopes on Earth and in space, and has woven them seamlessly to produce a holistic view of the universe. It's going to change the way we do astronomy. It's going to change the way we teach astronomy. And I think most importantly, it's going to change the way we see ourselves in the universe. If we were having this TED meeting in our grandparents' day, that might not be so big a claim. In 1920, for example, you weren't allowed to drink. If you were a woman, you weren't allowed to vote. And if you looked up at the stars in the Milky Way on a summer night, what you saw was thought to be the entire universe. In fact, the head of Harvard's observatory back then gave a great debate in which he argued that the Milky Way galaxy was the entire universe. Harvard was wrong big time. Of course, we know today that galaxies extend far beyond our own galaxy. We can see all the way out to the edge of the observable universe, all the way back in time, almost to the moment of the Big Bang itself. We can see across the entire spectrum of light, revealing worlds that had previously been invisible. We see these magnificent star nurseries where nature has somehow arranged for just the right numbers and just the right sizes of stars to be born for life to arise. We see alien worlds. We see alien solar systems, 300 now and still counting. And they're not like us. We see black holes at the heart of our galaxy in the Milky Way and elsewhere in the universe where time itself seems to stand still. But until now, our view of the universe has been disconnected and fragmented, and I think that many of the marvelous stories that nature has to tell us have fallen through the cracks, and that's changing. I want to just briefly mention three reasons why my colleagues and I in astronomy and in education are so excited about the World Wide Telescope and why we think it's truly transformative. First, it enables you to experience the universe. The World Wide Telescope, for me, is a kind of magic carpet that lets you navigate through the universe where you want to go. Second, you can tour the universe with astronomers as your guides. And I'm not talking here about just experts who are telling you what you're seeing, but really people who are passionate about the various nooks and crannies of the universe, who can share their enthusiasm and can make the universe a welcoming place. And third, you can create your own tours. You can share them with friends. You can create them with friends. And that's the part that I think I'm most excited about, because I think that at heart, we are all storytellers. And in telling stories, each of us is going to understand the universe in our own way. We're going to have a personal universe. I think we're going to see a community of storytellers evolve and emerge. Before I introduce the person responsible for the World Wide Telescope, I just want to leave you with this brief thought. When I ask people, how does the night sky make you feel? They often say, oh, tiny. I feel tiny and insignificant. Well, our gaze fills the universe. And thanks to the creators of the World Wide Telescope, we can now start to have a dialogue with the universe. I think the World Wide Telescope will convince you that we may be tiny, but we are truly wonderfully significant. Thank you.
You know, I'll admit it. My kids have had access to this now for a month or so. I've got a 9-year-old and a 7-year-old. They're just excited. The educational value of this, I think, is going to be tremendous. Curtis Wong is actually in the room. Curtis, you want to stand up? Curtis is the one that's really led this project. And I think I saw Jonathan here earlier, but I think he may have gone back to the demo room. But this has been an extraordinary effort. I think you'll really be excited when you have a chance to see it here, and it'll be made available to the public toward the end of the spring, sort of late springish time frame. Now, as you walk around, you're going to see projects in all stages of development, early stage, middle, some of them are closer to potential productization. People always ask me, but what's going to be the next big thing? Is this really going to be great? But what's going to really happen to it? What you're seeing when you're at the TechFest, whenever you visit a research lab, you're seeing raw material. I mean, scientists don't really create the future. We don't decide what the next big thing is. We don't even usually know what it is. What we do is we create the raw materials. People really create the future from that. we generate artifacts, we try out ideas, you know, but it is the product creators, the developers, the program managers, it's the individuals in the way they use the software, it's the societies in which we live. They really decide what happens. They decide what's going to be important and what's going to be big. And so as you walk around, you should keep that in mind. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Rick. That was a great overview of Microsoft Research and the work that we're doing here. It's actually a rare privilege for me to introduce the next two gentlemen who are going to join us on stage. Many of you are probably already familiar with Craig Mundy, the Chief Research and Strategy Officer for Microsoft. He's been with the company for quite a while now. We're also very fortunate to have with us this morning Alan Alda, who is obviously a very well-known television and movie actor, and he's also been the host of Scientific American Frontiers on PBS. So this is actually an area around science and technology and computing that's near and dear to his heart, and he has a lot of interesting thoughts. In fact, both Craig and Alan share a conviction that technology and science can help transform society, and they're going to join us this morning on stage and share with all of us some of their thoughts on the topic. So please join me in welcoming Craig Mundy and Alan Alda.
Thanks, Kevin. Thank you. When Kevin was doing his introduction, he said, we have two people. I'm sure you know one of them. I expected he was going to say Alan, and not me. Alan and I actually met about 5+ years ago. We were both at a meeting in Beijing, and we were attending an international conference associated with the Museum of Radio and Television. And we were sort of thrust together in an opportunity to talk. And you know, I'm very technology oriented, you could say. And I discovered almost immediately that while many people would know Alan for his work in MASH and other TV activities, he really was tremendously interested in technology. And you know, we immediately lapsed into a discussion about, you know, what the latest gadgets were and the problems he was having with Windows and, you know, other things. And
not that many.
But I promised to help with those. But we became friendly and have continued our interaction on and off over the last 5 years. And when we were talking about putting together this year's TechFest and trying to help people understand how computer science is essentially moving beyond, you know, just helping our engineers write the code for the next product at Microsoft, but is really becoming an integral part of how pretty much every facet of daily life happens, and increasingly how all aspects of science and engineering are done. We wanted to sort of have a dialogue about that aspect of the thing, and not so much talk about the technology, but the impact of the technology. And I said, you know, they said, you know, who could you have this conversation with? And I said, Alan. And so I called him up, and he agreed to fly out today and join us for this discussion. And I want to thank you for doing that.
Oh, it's been so terrific. I had a chance to go in this morning with Craig before before this presentation started, and we saw stuff which I guess you'll get to see in the next few minutes. And it was an amazing, and we only looked at 4 or 5 of the exhibits, but each one of them you could have spent a couple of hours at figuring out what they were trying to do and how they had accomplished what they were doing, what the ramifications of those things are. One of the most amazing things I saw today was that, I think it was one of the last things you just saw here, that that program that enables you to zoom in on points of light in the night sky and suddenly find out that you're looking at nebulae, or you're looking at
the worldwide telescope.
Well, I think that they mentioned that you can create your own tour. An individual user can create his or her own tour of stars and star systems, and then provide a commentary and pass that on to a friend. And sometimes the person who does it will be an expert, and sometimes the person who does it will be just a curious person. And the most amazing thing I saw this morning was this tour created by a six-year-old boy. And you hear this six-year-old voice with all this enthusiasm and the wonder of a child leading you through the universe in a knowledgeable way. I mean, he was, on here, this is M3. This is a really interesting place, you know.
Not sure what M3 is, he says, but I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm not sure what it is, but it's really interesting.
And those light years, that's a long bicycle ride.
Great. There was a great moment because you saw in that brief tour, you had a hint, a smell of what the impact of something like this can be in terms of education and in terms of communication of science.
Yeah, I think, you know, when you even take the World Wide Telescope and look at it, you say there's a number of interesting things there. Of course, there's the technology of how do you capture those images, process the images, register them, overlay them, because to some extent it's such a huge body of work that if an individual astrophysicist had to sit there and try to do that for their own work, it would be impossible.
It's really interesting. I don't know if it was spoken about on the video, that these images exist on hard drives all over the world, and you're drawing on them and stitching them together
right
on the fly.
So we're making a, if you will, a community of computers, you know, that is supported by a community of people who are both contributing to and then drawing knowledge from the ability to do that. And then, you know, coupled with the ability to teach through it and to create the storytelling that goes on in that, I think is an interesting aspect. Curtis, you know, before he did the telescope, was involved in a lot of the early work in multimedia titles, including some of the famous ones that were done around art. And I think that, you know, his ability to blend that storytelling capability with the core science is a key part of that. A number of things that we looked at this morning, I think, move us in this direction of augmenting how teaching will be done. The ability to bring people together in a collaborative way, I think, is a key attribute that we see emerging today. People are communicating through the internet a lot, but they haven't been collaborating through the internet all that much. And I think that step up from communication to collaboration, whether real time or otherwise, is going to be one of the transformational things that happens, not just in the enterprise for workers, but for everybody, no matter what their quest
within is. A family, look, figuring out what to do about Johnny, who's liable to get expelled from school, you know, or figuring out a vacation spot that the whole family would be able to enjoy. I think that's an interesting model, because the kind of collaboration you're talking about, different from the kind of collaboration that takes place just by virtue of the ability to communicate, is significant, I think, because time is it's happening in real time. This kind of collaboration, time after time this morning, I saw collaboration that was possible and computer modeling that was possible, where things happened in real time. And that means that when you suggest something to me, I can have an immediate response to it.
Right.
And I don't think about it. I don't look down in the email to where you said it and then respond in a more formal way to it. It's much more intuitive.
Yeah, and that moves us in a direction, again, we showed Alan some things today that are in this vein of what we call the natural user interface, where, you know, the machinery of interacting with the computer is receding from consciousness. You know, it becomes a more natural experience. You can collaborate without having to think a lot about it.
Yeah.
Mary Morse spoke here too, and we looked at her work. We also looked at another component of it, where some of the work from MSR Bangalore, which we call multipoint, where you can plug multiple mice, computer mice, into a single computer, project that on a screen in the classroom or in front of a small display, and the kids can come together and use it. And each of them has their own distinguished cursor. But we've been able to make interesting ways for the kids who don't have access to individual computers to be able to collaborate, you know, in a microcosmic way, even within that application.
I bet it's going to be very interesting to find out in the future, if the kids experience working a computer in collaboration with other kids that this kid knows and is used to working with, if that kid's experience is going to be significantly different from the experience of working on a single computer. I mean, right now we think the kid is lucky to have his or her own computer. The kid might be luckier to be forced to collaborate with other kids on a computer. If that social experience might lead to more learning.
Yeah, I think that both are going to come into play. In fact, it's not here at TechFest, but Microsoft Research has supported a piece of work down at the Catholic University in Santiago, Chile, which you didn't see this morning, but I'll explain a little because it's in the vein you described. There they gave small pocket computers to each kid in the classroom. So in a sense, they each had their own.
Yeah.
But the curriculum was developed such that each stage of the problem solving had to have a contribution from each of three kids. So they were broken into teams.
Oh.
And each team had to ultimately cross the finish line with the problem to get a grade.
Yeah.
But each kid had to solve part of the problem themselves. And in fact, you know, they have video studies of these classes where before this technology was introduced, you know, you'd have the kid who was the smartest in the class or the one who always wanted to be, you know, visible would dominate. But once this happened, it was a great equalizer. And then the kids would actually start helping each other because they said, hey, I can't get my part if you don't get your part, so I'll go over and help you learn about this. So I think the collaboration, whether through multiple use on one computer or innovative ways of linking the computers together, whether locally or across the internet, I think this collaboration thing is a big deal.
I think so too, and it really hit me strongly this morning as we went through that festival, and exhibit after exhibit seemed to indicate that you're putting your finger in something that hasn't really been explored much. It seems to me the benefit of building a giant brain out of the various brains that exist around the world, or the brains that exist in a classroom. The smartest kid in the class now has to share some of his brain with the other kids without sitting in the car in the parking lot letting them copy his homework. I mean, this is a much better way to do it.
Yeah.
But the idea that the knowledge and the ability and the analytic skills and the modeling skills of scientists around the world get focused onto a screen that I can look at, and I don't have the programming skills to bring that together, and I don't have the knowledge to put those ideas together myself. But to make use of all of these brains and make them work, and then to take the data and put that all together. For instance, in the model of the cell,
right,
or the rainforest. Collecting the data from all over, the way you are with those sensors.
Right. Yeah.
And when you combine those and you combine the collection of the data with the modeling of it, and you start to put these programs together, I don't think this kind of stuff has been done before.
Not at this scale. I think, you know, the last big evolutionary step in this, you could say, was when the PC got introduced with word processing and spreadsheets. Those were tools that moved the abstraction of how you interact and get things done up a level. Before that, you had to be a programmer, you know, yourself, and actually write a program to do something. And very few people really were adept at that. But when you could give them a spreadsheet as a metaphor that they could understand the cells, and you write little formulas, link them all together, you know, people were able to do incredibly interesting models within that environment. Some of the things we showed you this morning, I think, are the beginning of, again, making a qualitative change in the level of abstraction of the tools that we're giving people.
Meaning what? What do you mean by that?
Well, as you know, when we were looking today at the tools that they were giving the climatologists, and the people studying the rainforests, he would basically just have little blocks that represented whole data sets. So he said, oh, I have that data set over there about the currents in the ocean. And he said, oh, and here's one about the wind. And he would basically just take those things and he would drag and drop lines together onto the globe. And they would essentially connect him through the internet to those data sources, and then it would draw pictures of them, you know, and map them onto the globe. And much as we saw with the Worldwide Telescope, where each astrophysicist or astronomer, you know, they might have spent their lifetime, as Roy Gould said, I think, in the video, studying one cluster, or, you know, they would study the ultraviolet spectrum and somebody else would do the infrared spectrum. They never actually saw this stuff together. And so whether it was out in space or here, we were giving people tools now to bring things in where they don't think about writing a program. They don't even think about even filling out cells of a spreadsheet. They basically just sort of reach out and say, bring me all the data from that environment. And one of the big improvements there is the data now is becoming more self-describing. You don't have to have somebody who describes, you know, in advance to you, what is all that data? You know, what's the format of it? You know, what does it really represent? What's its scale, et cetera? We can put metadata in these things that allow all these programs that never knew about each other before to essentially bring the data together, composite it in new and interesting ways, and therefore it supports this collaboration process or this joint discovery process at a level that really never has been done before.
Am I right about this? I got the impression that a good example of that was the ability to model what was happening in the cell. All the different parts of the cell, you could see them going through a process, and you could put them through a process experimentally and see if you were right about it. Is this an example of saying about the
It is another example that Alan's talking about this modeling language that Stephen Emmett, I think, actually talked about in the video on Rick's talk, where cell biology is incredibly complex. So the solar system, you know, and space, and, you know, that's huge and complex. But even down at the level of, you know, cellular biology, these cells are incredibly complex machines. And so, you know, again, we see people spending their careers studying one little, you know, pathway in a cellular interaction, you know, one, you know, effect of genes and proteins. And the question is, how do you bring all that together? So we're now giving them tools that allow them to describe the cell biology, but not just to describe it, but that description itself becomes a model. It's sort of like, you know, the spreadsheet of the cell. And therefore you can calculate the model. So even though in the wet lab it might be only possible to say, well, I could see what the cell was doing when it started, and then I could see where it was at the end. But man, the chemical cascade is either complex and I don't understand it, or it's actually happening at a speed where I can't really stop it midway and understand, but I know there's something going on. There hasn't been a great way for them to express it or explore it. So by, again, abstracting that into these computer-based models, you can take something as complex as cellular biology and begin to give people tools for this collaboration of their, you know, of their work, and then ultimately this ability to make some type of joint insight.
I love that expression, the spreadsheet of the cell, because it's a very close analogy, because you can tweak the cell as if you were giving it a drug.
That's right.
But you don't have to give a real cell a drug, and you can see the reaction you're getting. You can do experiments on the computer to some extent, can't you?
Yes, and I think one of the things that's going to be important is this ability to transcend physical scale. Yeah. You know, from literally the atomic, you know, to the universe, and the, you know, of course, without computing, we don't have a way to give, you know, humans the ability to interact at scale across these things. And I think, you know, for the first time, we're really doing that with a level of detail and precision that was never possible. This cellular modeling is interesting, not just because it helps us understand the most basic processes, but it holds the potential, as our computational assets and understanding increase, to move toward things like system biology, which essentially is building bigger and bigger computer models of the entire network of interactions. Many people now think that you know, biology is a network of networks, sort of like the internet is.
Yeah.
And that if we knew how they all worked at each level, and we could compose them into bigger and bigger models, in fact, the things that you talked about of, you know, the future of understanding medicine or pharmacology, you know, could be explored without actually doing it initially, you know, in living organisms.
It's something that I kept asking as we were going through the exhibit. Was how do I get my hands on this, or who gets their hands on it? Is this, because when I looked at the all the, you know, the night sky on the computer screen and watched, saw zooming down into these star systems, I thought, so what is this connected to some giant computer that I had, that a lab has to buy? And it turns out, what did you say? It was a plug-in
Internet Explorer.
That's unbelievable.
Well, that one wasn't specifically that.
No, but
that was an application.
Right?
Well, there are elements of it that you can get in the frame of a browser, and in fact, you can send people links, you know, through the internet or through email that would allow them to go. That particular application that Curtis wrote is a specific piece of software that, you know, takes in all of these things and presents it in that nice environment. But certainly a number of the things that we did show you today, Mary's work in terms of the shared user interface, the work in climatology, those were in fact browser plugins where, you know, we're essentially taking a piece of software, adding it, you know, into the browser as a frame in which it executes, which allows you to have, you know, an intelligent way of interacting around this topic, and then the traditional browser presentation for the rendering or the integration with other web data assets. So, you know, it's a new way for people, again, to put things together and make them easily available. You know, today we refer to a lot of this as sort of click to run, you know, where you didn't have it before and you found it on the web through a search or a link somebody sent you. You click the link and you're running it because it just comes down through the internet, executes in your machine, takes advantage of the local, you know, computational or storage facilities that are there, but blends it seamlessly into this internet experience.
How did Microsoft get started in this? Because this seems like, I'll just give you the background of my question, what I mean by this question. You're dealing with basic research, and some of the things that I saw today are extremely exciting because it seems to me it'll raise the level of education and it'll raise the level of communication of science to ordinary people and raise the level of communication among scientists, which is extremely important. That doesn't necessarily feed into the coffers of Microsoft. And this is basic research that doesn't necessarily lead to a product, right? How did Microsoft decide to do that?
I think there's several things that come together here. One, as Rick said, you know, the fundamental raw material of Microsoft is smart people.
Yeah.
And the output of those people is intellectual property, intellectual, you know, assets that we try to deploy in a wide variety of ways. One way is we use it to enhance the products we have. Two, we use it to create new products that we never had before in our traditional field. And three, we use it to either respond to opportunities or things that are happening in the society at large or even on a competitive basis. And so the research is the mechanism that allows us to continue to draw that in. One of the things that is different, though, the last few years is moving beyond just using this computer science research in the computing problems itself. You know, as you and I discussed before, Bill will retire from Microsoft, Bill Gates, you know, and spend most of his time at the foundation at the end of June. And this year in January at Davos, he gave a speech, which I think I call his transitional speech, because, you know, he's now both famous for the work that he's done here, but he and Melinda are now increasingly famous for the work they did in the foundation, too. And he introduced a phrase that he called creative capitalism in that talk. And he said, look, you know, today we have 1.5 billion people who do pretty well on the planet. We've got another 2 billion today that are sort of coming online. And then there's at least another 2 billion people that really, you know, live a subsistence existence. And if we're ultimately going to improve the lot in life of all of those people, in his mind, it's pretty clear that neither government or philanthropy will be able to do it by itself. So one of the things that Bill has encouraged, and which we've done, I'd say, in some natural way with this MSR work, is to take some part of the company's assets and in service of helping solve these societal problems. And whether they're in education or health or farming productivity or the water table, many of these challenges that the global society is going to have cannot really be addressed at scale without the use of computing and software. And notably, at least in Bill's mind, they ultimately can't be addressed at scale unless the big multinational companies begin to figure out how to at least make a business or a break-even activity out of helping at some of these other levels. So partly that's been the motivation for us to go beyond just using computer science to improve our computer products, but to actually take people into the company and to create more relationships around the world with people who aren't the computer scientists, but really are the scientists and engineers who are trying to solve some of society's toughest problems. So whether it's working to help with the genetic analysis of the AIDS virus to look for a vaccine, or modeling the water table at Berkeley. We showed you, for example, the sensors that Feng Zhao's done, and one place where we're doing a project is in the Alps, where they're basically measuring the retreat of the glaciers in the Alps.
So you drop these sensors all around in the Alps and they communicate with each other.
Right, they collect data about wind and temperature and reflectivity and pollutants, and all of these things essentially are a way of trying to understand how either global warming or the actions of man or something are going to affect the glaciers, which turn out to be the source of all the fresh water supply in that part of Central Europe. And so, we look at each of these problems, the cell biology problem, and its future impact on medicine, all these areas, they all have applicability, not just in the traditional places, as you say, where we make money, but it's important to, that the company contribute to the resolution of these other problems.
And how long will you stick with an exploration if it seems there's no hope of it producing a product?
Well, I don't know that we've been at it long enough to fail a lot and be able to say there's a general way to answer that question. The one thing that has been an attribute of the company commercially forever is we're very persistent. I came here 15 years ago to start non-PC computing, and one of the first things we started on was television, interactive television. And today it's called IPTV, and it's only now becoming sort of mass deployed on a global basis. So the cycle time of these things that are changing society's infrastructure is pretty long, 10, 15 years or more. And I think the Microsoft has been willing to make long-term investments, not just in the research itself, but it's in its application, and being patient about how long it takes to make these things emerge.
And if one of the programs that's on exhibit in the other room, if that continues to have beneficial effects in terms of education or science or both, but it looks like it'll never turn into a product that Microsoft can sell, will you stick with that?
Again, I don't know there's a universal answer, but I think we will continue to look for ways to place these things where the benefit can continue. Yeah. I don't know that we would always just keep doing it ourselves, but that's why I think that, as Bill said, this concept of creative capitalism requires some intersection between the role of government, the role of philanthropy, and the role of business. And we might say, hey, look, this thing is never going to be a business. But if it turns out it's the key to improving agriculture for poor people in rural Indonesia, we might find a way to transfer that technology to the academics in Indonesia. Yeah. So I think we will look not just to develop these things, but to find ways to let their benefit be sustained over long periods of time.
There also, it seems to me, there's also a model for doing this work in the first place, which involves handing it off at a certain point. Otherwise, the body of work just keeps growing and chokes on its own size.
That's right. And, even within our own research efforts, not everything we explore materializes something that we know exactly what to do with it.
Yeah.
And so we have a variety of ways we deal with the ultimate disposition of the research activities. Some of them just get transferred as technology into the product groups. And those 6,000 people that will wander around the exhibits here from Microsoft this week, that's a key part of how that technology transfer happens. The second thing we do is sometimes we need to take some of these concepts or a set of the research assets and bring them together to create a conceptually new thing. What Curtis did with the Worldwide Telescope, I think, is an example of that, where there wasn't an individual product group you could go to at Microsoft and say, you should take all of these particular technologies and just use them, because you had to show how they could be composited in a way that did something that hadn't been done before. And so that may become either a service or a product. I mean, in this case, we've decided to make the Worldwide Telescope available to the world for free. Mm-hmm. And that's just a contribution of Microsoft to the community. And as such, it becomes a repository for all of the work that science community will do. The third thing that we do is sometimes we bring these things forward in ways that allow us to create fundamentally new businesses. One of the areas we started 3 years ago was a business in health. And one of the things that certainly motivated me to think we could make a contribution there was looking at how health itself, health care, is going to evolve. On one hand, medicine is going to become a more data-driven business. I mean, when we were down there looking at the cell biology and the computer models of these things, I mean, at some very, very low level, there's computing is going to be important there. But genomics and proteomics, the use of these things to really get benefit has to be made personalized. And to some extent, the amount of data that has to be collected, analyzed, maintained, integrated, and studied in order to produce a personal prescription or a personal pharmaceutical almost, it will dwarf, all the data that has been used in medicine up to this point. And so, when I look at the research assets, whether they're in image processing, for example, one of the biggest breakthroughs in medicine in the last decades was all the imaging. Started with X-rays, and now we got CAT scans and PET scans and MRI scans, and all that imaging has been a huge and valuable diagnostic tool. But much as what's happened with the space guys, no one today registers all those images. Every image that you've ever had of an X-ray, and say, hey, can you look at them all at once?
Yeah.
Can you actually take volumetric scans, like a whole body CAT scan, and then correlate it with individual PET scans or MRI scans? Would that be useful or interesting? Would it be like the scientists who are looking at that Worldwide Telescope and say, hey, I never ever saw my data in context? I think in medical imaging, we're likely to see that, and some of the things that we do there may be able to be brought into the medical sphere. So and then the other thing I think is going to happen globally in healthcare is that it's going to shift to a focus on prevention, personal involvement. And so many of these things where communities or families or individuals are brought together, either because they share an interest in a disease, some member of the family have it, or you may want to talk to other people who have a chronic disease that you have. All of these mechanisms in the internet, I think, are going to be very powerful in bringing together not just the medical and research community, but the actual individuals who either care about wellness or have a particular interest in a specific health-related matter. And then allowing that energy to be harnessed in some way is another thing I think that we would like to do. So there are many ways that we take individual components of the research, none of which were started for the specific purpose, mm-hmm. Of serving a need of the company in health. Some of the work that's done here in the machine learning area, Eric Horvitz's group, David Heckerman, Naboja Jojak, these guys they started out doing machine vision, they got to machine learning, and a few years ago they got asked to look at the AIDS virus, the people who were searching the genome sequences of the AIDS virus. And they were able to create a new way of using machine learning to study this that all of the people in the medical community had never really thought about, and to recreate the experience and understanding in a short amount of time that the world had spent 5 years looking for up to that time.
I was wondering, as you were saying that, if eventually you'd be able to use this model of the sensors in the same way that you planted the sensors on the glacier, and are studying how the glacier actually deteriorates, under what forces, and then and through what dynamics it goes. I wonder if you could use a similar technique to and apply it to epidemiological problems like the spread of bird flu, and to see where things start to crop up and find out what the pathways are and see if you can choke it off at an early time, and human diseases.
Yeah, actually, Stephen Emmett, we didn't have time to show you that this morning, but one of the other projects that group is doing is with one of the universities in the UK is actually having a model of large-scale, almost global epidemiology, and being able to do that kind of thing. What's interesting is that you don't just have to use sensors in some discrete way to do that. Some of the work that we've been helping with in India, for example, is where people use cell phones to report anomalous observations.
Yeah.
So, for example, I saw a dead bird. Birds don't usually drop out of the sky here, and this one did.
Yeah.
And they've sensitized the population, say, hey, you know, bird flu, yet weird birds do weird things, they die in ways that you don't normally observe. And so if you see that, send a little SMS message to this number.
Yeah.
And so all these messages come in with you know, some triangulation from the cell, or they put their location in, and you start to build maps of where these things are happening.
Yeah.
And then you use the internet to collect these things and scale them up. And in fact, the population at large is becoming the sensor network
that
basically, you know, make judgments or provide raw data, which you can then mine and do noise reduction on and determine, you know, is there a pattern here that's anomalous? One of the things we learned, dealing with the health of computers as opposed to the health of people, was years ago using some techniques that came from research and the Windows group, we built this error reporting mechanism. You know, almost everybody who uses our software today at some point, some bad thing happens. Your app crashes or the machine has a problem and it says, hey, can I send some data to Microsoft? And so we get millions and millions of what you could have said were random, almost, pieces of data from all the kinds of failures out there.
These are failures on
a computer.
Individual computers.
Yeah, individual computers, one at a time.
Yeah.
But when we look at them on a worldwide basis, we discovered we could learn things that we never anticipated by doing pattern matching and machine learning on these kind of things. So today, we not only are able to find an individual, literally almost an individual machine that breaks for some anomalous reason, say, no, your machine just broke, all right? And distinguish that from, you know, the introduction of a virus, for example.
Uh-huh.
So today, we can detect the release of computer viruses around the world because some of the machines that get infected start to have failures, and the failures get reported, and that machine wasn't failing yesterday. In fact, the whole group of machines here weren't failing yesterday, and today they're all failing. And when they all send the reports in, little sensors go off at Microsoft that said, you know, something's happening, you know, in Jakarta this morning, and, you know, we should go figure out what it is. And you look at it and say, oh, look, somebody released a virus, and it's spreading out of Jakarta today, and, you know, we better figure out how to stop it. And so essentially we're dealing with epidemiology in the computer network.
Yes, yeah, that's
and great. The question is, how do you take that learning and bring it over to epidemiology?
But that's a theme that goes throughout that exhibit. And one is collecting and amalgamating data that hadn't been collected before and massaged, and collecting and amalgamating brains. So putting those two things together, I wonder if that isn't going to have an effect that we can't imagine now. Just in the same way, I had so many friends that I became interested in computers and trying to learn simple computing languages like 15 or 20 years ago, 25 years ago. And I had so many friends who said, well, what would I do with a computer? I'd like to get one, but I don't know what I'd do with it.
Right.
And as soon as they got one, they found out what they could do with it. And I'm wondering if some of the things in the other room there are going to have the same reaction on people.
Well, I think they will. In fact, I think that today many people in the science and engineering community have a bit of a way of thinking about computers roughly the same way they think about pencils and graph paper and things. You know, I mean, it's a tool. I wouldn't want to do my science without, you know, having these tools. But you know, many of them haven't yet made the leap to understand, you know, this may be able to affect my science in a more profound way than I thought, either because it brings me access to data that I didn't know exist or didn't have any reasonable way of integrating into my own work, or in fact, it couples me into this giant brain pool, you know, in ways that I would not have historically done. And I do think that these are going to produce, not, I think, qualitative changes in the results. I actually think it's going to result in an acceleration of science. We've already seen, you know, knowledge growing at exponential rates, but I think that supplemented by this level of computational horsepower and the connectivity and collaboration that's promoted through the connectedness here and the tools to support discovery and sharing, I think is going to produce another significant acceleration.
Well, how would you, that seems like such an important idea. You're distinguishing between analytic tools. The computer up until now has largely been an analytic tool, like a good slide rule,
mm-hmm.
Or a good piece of graph paper.
Big calculator.
Yeah. And this is something else. This is, but I can't put a name on it. What?
Well, I think, no, I don't know how to name it, but I think this idea that you're able to more or less directly manipulate very large data sets or interact, you know, at large with big groups of people without having to think a lot about it makes this collaboration a lot more possible. The ability to just use data you didn't know existed. I mean, I think one of the things that people are fascinated by when you give them, you know, a broadband connection, a personal computer, a web browser, and a search engine, you know, you don't have to teach them almost anything, and they discover that there's a lot of stuff out there.
Yeah.
And that, you know, just type anything in, something comes back. You know, that becomes a training mechanism.
Yeah.
Where, you know, you poke it, it comes back with something. You follow that link, you know, you go again. And this, I think, recursion is a very natural thing in terms of people's curiosity and interests. What we're doing now is allowing simple mechanisms like that to be applied to things that are wildly more complex,
yeah.
and to be integrated in some way that makes them useful without having to stop and learn a huge amount about all the work that everybody else did. I think, you know, one of the things that we've struggled with in computing and software in particular in the past was that our tools didn't really lend themselves to composition. People tended to say, I'm going to write an application, a piece of software. You sit there and you write the whole thing. You may use some little libraries. But at the end of the day, you know, you architected and wrote this application, big or small. But once you had that application, unless you had specifically thought about how it was going to relate to other applications, they frequently couldn't talk.
Yeah.
So the last few years, the introduction of metadata and the formal ways of describing it, like XML, has had a huge effect in allowing people to contemplate the use of data that they didn't know about in advance. And I think as we now move to these higher level abstractions for how people will, quote, program the computer, where they're not sitting down and casting programs sort of one imperative statement at a time, but are linking together the works of other people, much the way that you know, people who design buildings or bridges and other things, you know, they take the work of lots of other people. You know, some guy's a specialist in concrete and foundations and steel and girders, and you bring them together through software that aids that. We've never really empowered people at any scale to build bigger and bigger edifices, you know, that are these computer programs all working together. But I think what you're observing as you walk around today is that we're moving beyond this traditional model of writing programs or designing them for a priori interaction with another set of programs to a world that's a lot more free form in your ability to discover, link it in, and then utilize it.
It's almost like the difference between when we had to walk around and look for a bush to pick berries from. That was like a first step. And then we figured out that we could grow farms of berry bushes. And that's, in a way, the way we've been using computers up until now. And now, you've got farms of berry bushes that are producing bowls of chicken gumbo.
I mean, or something.
I mean, it's like it goes to a whole other level that's much more complex and yet feeds it to us at a much simpler, easier to understand level.
Yeah, these ideas that the man-machine interface is getting easier, whether it's moving beyond typing and pointing with a mouse. We looked at that sort of research on the touch interface, where people say, look, it's really natural to look at a picture and touch it, but if it's an electronically generated image and your interaction is through your finger, you don't have the kind of resolution you want. You have the occlusion of the picture while you're trying to interact with it.
You have to learn which part of your finger is going to eventually touch it.
Either that or genetically we're going to evolve to have very pointy fingers.
Yes, right.
So that you can really point with precision. But I think we also see this desire for mobility, the ability to use computing not just at my desk or when I can move my desk someplace else with a laptop. But today everybody's use of cell phones, the idea that you have this thing in your pocket, it's always on your person, you can get at a lot of information, is creating more and more desire to have access to these things in a portable environment. As we move to introduce, you could say there's, we showed you both ends of the scale today in some of the research, the Worldwide Telescope, which is a at a dimensionality that's hard to fathom in big scale. And then we're down there looking at some of the cell biology and very, very tiny things. But I think one of the things that's going to be interesting is the work of blending together the real world and some synthetic world. Today, everybody thinks about that as mapping. You can look at maps, virtual Earth or Google Maps and others are ways for everybody to say, if I wanted to have a map before, I'd have to get the atlas out or I'd have a little local map. But the ability to go and zoom in to any place on the planet and see the roads and the trees and the aerial photography, that was a big step. But now we can think about using that to synthesize a model of the world, and then to be able to populate that model with more and more precision, and then to study things at that scale or allow models of interaction that are, again, very natural. I did some demos yesterday for some folks that showed what it might be like to take pictures of the real world and from that create a 3D model of the real world. And then to do that not just for the exterior and facades of buildings, but to be able to go into a building or a store and have a physical model of the interior too.
No, that involves, does that involve somebody going in and shooting the picture and putting it somewhere? Use of pictures you've got or what?
Either one. You can take a bunch of individual photos. You could put little webcams in the corner of your store.
Yeah.
And once an hour it could take another set of pictures. And from that it could...
So then sitting at home, I can go shopping in that store in 3D.
Correct. And so... this will be another model of natural user interface because what it's like to be in the store physically. It turns out, people have their brain really likes it, relates to this visual presentation of a real 3D environment. We showed you that soft shadow stuff today.
Yeah.
And it was important to see how the visual cues that you get from the shadows were important in your own ability or comfort in looking at these images.
A couple of computerized figures, computer-generated figures, but they looked so much more real simply because they had little soft light shadows on the ground under them, and some of those shadows in their features were. It gave it a more believable modeling because intuitively there was a real light source and that they were existing in some world like yours. That's how I would describe it.
No, that's exactly right. And so all of these things are computationally intense problems. I mean, a few years ago, before Microsoft 15 years ago, I was in the supercomputing business. And the machines that we would build and sell for $1 million a copy couldn't come close to computing, those shadow images that you saw on those figures today.
Well, what's the difference? Better machines or better algorithms?
A little bit of both. As he pointed out this morning in the shadow work, that even the best machines we have, these incredibly powerful graphics computers, are not really capable of doing all of the individual ray tracing to give you the shadow calculation in real time. And so in animated movies, you know, that's fine. You don't have to do it in real time. But if you're trying to make this into a 3D model, people are going to walk around and go shopping, and it has to have some kind of real-time nature. Yeah. So there the breakthrough was algorithms on top of the hardware advances. And I think that's always going to be the case, that our aspiration in terms of the visual quality or the degree of resolution that you have will continue to always outstrip our current ability to compute it. But, you know, we are moving ahead to a world where there will be more and more parallel computation. I think, you know, one of the biggest changes that's going to come in computing in the next few years, probably the biggest change in the last 30 or 40, is that the computing itself is going to have to evolve to be more based on parallelism to get performance.
What's going to make that happen? What has to be done? What has to be worked on?
Well, almost everything. The hardware is going to have to change architecturally. Human nature is parallel,
yeah.
You know, and to some extent, you know, nobody goes around and figures out, you know, how gravity here relates to, you know, anything else, and you don't design it, but it all runs in parallel all the time.
Yeah.
And yet, the way we built computers, they're all running in serial, and everything has to be very carefully constructed. And we've made them very, very fast, and so they do a lot of really interesting stuff. But to some extent, they're, you know, you still do a lot better. You know, if you were to assign sort of a clock speed to a person, a biological system, its system clock would probably be something like 30 hertz. And, you know, and the current computers are 3 gigahertz. All right, so, you know, there's, 10 to the 8th difference in clock speed. But you think, you reason, you navigate, you can figure out how to get out here and walk up the stairs. In computers, we're still struggling to figure out how to do that. What's the difference? You're massively parallel, and the computer isn't. You know, your algorithms are intrinsically, you know, operating all simultaneously, and those are not. The stuff we showed you in the cell biology work was showing that the only way we can model these things now was by assuming that everything was happening in parallel, that there was a stochastic or probabilistic element to it, and then trying to determine, you know, the way nature does, well, what's the right answer?
That's when you're working in the cell. You're working with the probabilities of one particle of the cell interacting with another.
Right. But in the future, I think more and more of those attributes will be how we build these computers. And, you know, the very next step for us is to not have, you know, millions and millions of computers on a die, but to have dozens or hundreds of them and then try to link them together so that they collaborate more on an individual problem.
Well, as long as we're talking about the murky future, what's going to happen as you look forward, say, to better parallel computing? How is that going to be affected by, let's say 10 years from now, somebody making a really functional quantum computer where you're working with multiple states and not just ones and zeros? What's that going to do to you? I mean, you're going to have to rethink everything?
Well, that one will require a rethinking, I think. But I don't think that's going to happen in the next 10 years. We have a project that's working in quantum computation.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, my expectation is that's not going to materialize in any kind of general sense in that short a time cycle. I think that's, you know, 20 years and beyond.
Yeah.
But there are a certain class of problems that that'll be good for. You know, Michael Friedman, who is the guy that started that work, when we talked about starting this project, I said, well, let's go convert this from a math theory into an experiment. And we actually, you know, set out to do that with a bunch of physicists down in California. We moved the lab there. And when he was doing this, I said to him one day, I said, okay, you know, everybody talks about quantum computers and what would they be good for? And, you know, people say, oh, well, you know, it could factor big numbers and therefore it would break graphic codes and that thing. So he said, yeah, you can do that. He says, but I said, well, what do you think, if we could make one of these things, the first one, what would you do with it? What would you do with it?
Yeah.
He said, oh, the first thing I would do is I would have it compute the materials for its successor. and which is a fascinating statement, because it turns out that the key to quantum computation is operating, you know, down in this quantum physics regime, which is just at millikelvin, you know, just thousandths of a degree above absolute zero. And these states only exist in current materials at that level.
Yeah.
And so that's really hard to make and keep at that temperature. So he said, so what you really want to do is you want to compute the properties of a synthetic material that would exhibit these properties at a slightly higher temperature. And then you could make a bigger one.
And you'd probably need a quantum computer to calculate.
No, that's exactly right. Today, it's completely intractable with computers as we know them to compute those materials.
But you know what worries me about this? Because of my history in entertainment, I think about the first film was Nitrate, and it disintegrated, mm-hmm. and sometimes went up in flames.
Yep.
But then when they changed the technology, they copied a lot of the old films and brought them forward. And we have them today because they did that. And then as we got digital, they did the same thing. But every time the technology changes, they have to make a decision.
Right.
They cull. It's like culling a herd.
Yeah.
And the ones that they transfer, that decision is made on the basis of the culture at the time. What seems important? What do we want to send into the future? They're constantly making these capsules for the future every time the technology changes. And when we go from ones and zeros to a completely different way of computing, there's going to be a gigantic culling of all knowledge, not just of movies. Yeah, what's going to happen?
I don't actually think about it that way, in part because I tend to think of the information and how it's represented as something slightly different than the model of computation that we, you know, sort of apply to the information.
But will this be so smart, this new one, new way of computing, which is maybe far less serious, is that going to be so smart that it can take everything that already exists on this one and learn how to translate it?
Yes. Now that I'm actually
we'll see.
Quite comfortable. but there is another fascinating thing that is happening now that wasn't happening that many years ago. And it's another area where some of Tony Hayes' projects at Microsoft Research are involved today. And it is with this question of digital libraries and the whole question of archiving, you know, the digital history.
Yeah.
And so, you know, when people were making these decisions step by step, you know, as a business decision, you know, they were guided by one thing. But of course, society has always depended on archivists, you know, whose mission wasn't to preserve everything, but to at least preserve a representative sample. One of the things that I think is really interesting today is that our ability to store things has grown in capacity to such a degree that you know, we're really getting close to approaching a time where almost nothing needs to be forgotten.
And then you have to worry how to search through it.
Well, and to some extent, you know, we're also getting to the point where we can find anything we've remembered. And so, I mean, at least at the scale of the web, you know, with billions and billions of pages of information, you know, we not only remember all those things, but we can find every one of them. You know, the next thing that's happening now is that we actually remember all of your interactions. So, for example, the advertising businesses that we're in and other people are in are increasingly saying, oh, I want to remember the things you like and you've done, because then if I have to give you an ad, I can figure out what it is.
Yeah.
And so on one hand, it's scary to some people, but on the other hand, you know, the ability for the machine to be an assistant in helping you to recall and to discover goes all the way back to the beginning of this conversation. It says, you know, if I'm a scientist and I'm trying to solve a problem, I really would love to find anybody who's got anything that contributes to knowledge in this space, or any person who can assist with this, and somehow bring them into my environment. And I think that the scale at which we're doing that today, mankind has never done before. And so as you talk about it, you know, we're sort of building, you know, this ability for mankind to work as a big brain, you know, supplemented by literally billions of artificial, you know, brains, in the sense of the computer algorithms and the machines that run them, that are really helping us to do these things. And, you know, it's clearly creating a projection of knowledge and capability in the future that you know, mankind has never known before. And, you know, I'm personally super optimistic about that. And I think that, behind that does lie ultimately solutions, scale solutions to, you know, global health and education and ultimately helping, you know, every person to, move themselves, you know, to an improved quality of life.
Are there efforts among the, people in the Microsoft Research to, and I imagine there are, to do what you were describing before, to bridge that gap between how the computer can approach the ability of a human to do simple things. I can recognize a face, I think, more easily than a computer can. I can recognize a voice more easily. I can do some spell checking a lot better because I can tell which word just plain doesn't go in that paragraph, even though it's spelled correctly.
Right.
You know, although there, it amazes me sometimes when I'm working in Word and it picks me up on a change of tense or something like that. And I'm grateful for it.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have noticed it reading through it 50 times.
Right. No, I mean, it understands grammar and it'll look at every word you type every time you type it and figure
but,
it out.
But these other things, you know, that we're going to need computers to do, to especially as they sense more and more, to be able to put two and two together, something like the way we do it, which is so efficient. So I mean, it's been developed over millennia, so we have a head start on computers. But is there much work being done on that?
Well, there is. You know, almost every human sense is, you know, being analyzed relative to how does the computer emulate that capability. Sight, sound, even smell, you know, haptics and other things, touch. You know, there's work going on here and elsewhere in the world in every one of these things. And the question is not how do you emulate those things, but taken one at a time, how do you integrate them into some system that would help people solve a problem or do something? You know, you see powerful examples of these things today where in medicine, you know, you're starting to see artificial limbs. I've seen, you know, people now who've lost their legs and you give them an artificial leg and it's not just a fixed thing that they stick on you. You know, it's a hydraulic motor operated, battery powered, you know, computerized thing. And you know, you've got the little intersections to the nerves and you really operate that machine. So I think there are many, many things that are going to happen that will qualitatively change people's lives for the better. It's been great talking to you this morning. Thanks again for coming in.
Had a good time. Thank you.
Wonderful.
Thanks an awful lot.
Take care. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank
you, Craig. Thanks. Well, thank you to Craig and Alan for that incredible conversation of the last hour. And thank you to all of you. Now is the exciting time. We get to throw open the doors literally to the demo room right across the hall here. We've got about a little over 30 different demos there for you to experience on your own, and the floor is going to be open till 4:30. The folks you're going to meet in the room are the real researchers who've invented the technologies, and we encourage all of you to explore the room, have, you know, great conversations with all of them. We've tried to pick a cross-section of technologies from, you know, the breadth of investments that you heard Rick and Craig talk about we're making MSR. I'm sure that not everything is going to appeal to everyone, but we've got enough stuff in there. You can spend the entire afternoon in fantastic conversations and not run out of stuff, no matter what your interests are. So we hope you have a fabulous time. Let us know if there's anything we can do for you over the course of the afternoon. Walk around, spend time at the booth that interests you. The room is going to be open till 4:30 this afternoon, and with that, I would say thank you for your time this morning and enjoy the rest of the day.